With its sleek, menacing twin-engine design merging seamlessly into a streamlined fuselage, the McDonnell XF-88 Voodoo was a revolutionary marvel of the late 1940s, born from the minds of visionary engineers at McDonnell Aircraft. The XF-88 boasted unprecedented agility and power, designed as the ultimate bomber escort, a supersonic watchdog of the skies, ready to shepherd bombers to their targets and back. First taking flight in October 1948, the XF-88 initially underperformed, but McDonnell's engineers pressed on, equipping the second prototype with afterburners. This leap forward catapulted the Voodoo to new heights, surpassing rivals and reaching speeds over 1,207.6 miles per hour, making it the fastest aircraft on Earth in the 1950s. However, the shifting Cold War landscape soon pivoted Air Force priorities from bomber escorts to interceptors, seemingly sealing the Voodoo's fate. McDonnell refused to let their creation fade. Through a bold redesign, the F-101 Voodoo emerged, larger, faster, and more powerful. With Pratt & Whitney J-57 turbojets and an iconic T-tail, the F-101 redefined aerial supremacy. From bomber escort to nuclear strike plane to ultimate reconnaissance aircraft, the Voodoo endured. When America faced the threat of nuclear annihilation, it was the F-101 that stood ready to save the day. The design of what would become the Voodoo jet was deeply rooted in the technological advances of German jet research during World War II, which McDonnell Aircraft Corporation adeptly harnessed to create a groundbreaking aircraft. Leveraging insights from captured German aeronautical data, McDonnell's design team embarked on a mission to develop a long-range, high-performance fighter jet to secure U.S. aerial supremacy in the post-war era. In June 1946, the U.S. Army Air Forces called for an advanced fighter to replace the venerable North American P-51 Mustang, which had excelled in escorting Boeing B-17 flying fortresses and consolidated B-24 Liberators during the war. The vision was clear: to craft an aircraft that could meet the demands of the nuclear age with unmatched speed, range, and agility. The XF-88 Voodoo was born on February 14, 1947, when a contract was granted for two prototype aircraft based on McDonnell's proposal, which had been enhanced with German jet propulsion technology. In October 1948, the first prototype flew to the sky from Morocco, propelled by two Westinghouse XJ-34W13 turbojets. Although the prototype showed promise, it needed further work to meet the demanding standards, especially with regard to its peak speed. In response, McDonnell engineers installed afterburners on the second prototype, which significantly improved thrust and overall performance. The Voodoo's agility, speed, and climb rate were all improved with this upgrade, but at the cost of increased fuel consumption and decreased range. The fate of the XF-88 Voodoo was suddenly threatened, despite its technological superiority and its triumph in a fly-off against the North American YF-93 and Lockheed XF-90. The strategic situation had drastically changed after the Soviet Union detonated the first nuclear weapon, so the newly formed United States Air Force started to concentrate on interceptor planes rather than long-range escorts. As a result, the Voodoo's operational deployment was curtailed when the penetration fighter program suddenly ended in 1950. Even before it began, Voodoo's career appeared to be done. The Cold War had the world in a panic, and the arms races between the East and the West had the world of combat aviation pushed to its limit, so much so that the United States Air Force decided to give the Voodoo design another chance. McDonnell proposed an advanced design that evolved from the XF-88, standing out among its competitors. By May 1951, McDonnell's design had captivated the Air Force, leading to the rechristening of the aircraft as the F-101 Voodoo in November of the same year. The Voodoo's redesign was extensive and meticulously engineered. At the heart of the aircraft's prowess were its twin Pratt and Whitney J-57 P-13 turbojets, which enabled rapid acceleration, a robust climb rate, and the ability to quickly break the sound barrier, reaching a top speed of Mach 1.52. Its extensive fuel capacity provided a remarkable range of approximately 3,000 miles, making it a capable long-range asset for the United States Air Force. The modifications included larger engine bays to accommodate the J-57S and redesigned air intakes optimized for high-speed airflow at transonic speeds, which is crucial for maintaining engine performance and stability. One of the most significant aerodynamic innovations was the Voodoo's T-tail configuration. This design was a response to the pitch-up problem encountered in the Douglas D-558-2 Skyrocket's flight tests. By elevating the horizontal stabilizer to the top of the vertical fin, the T-tail improved pitch control and stability, especially at high angles of attack, and minimized interference drag, providing better handling characteristics at supersonic speeds. As geopolitical priorities evolved, so did the Voodoo's mission profile. By late 1952, the Air Force re-envisioned the F-101 as a bomber escort and a nuclear-capable strategic fighter. This dual-role capability required extensive versatility, which McDonnell met with comprehensive design updates. The aircraft featured robust landing gear, advanced avionics, and provisions for carrying nuclear weapons. The landing gear of the F-101 Voodoo was designed to support the high-performance demands of this supersonic jet fighter. It featured a robust tricycle configuration comprising a single nose gear and dual central gear units. The nose gear, constructed with a hydraulic steering mechanism, provided precise directional control during ground operations. It retracted forward into the nose section of the aircraft, enhancing aerodynamics in flight. The main landing gear units mounted in the fuselage employed a dual-wheel arrangement to distribute the aircraft's weight more evenly, especially during high-speed landings. Central to its avionics was the MG-13 fire control system, which integrated a radar for target acquisition and tracking, facilitating the deployment of its AIM-4 Falcon missiles and unguided rockets. The Voodoo was also equipped with an APG-51 radar, providing robust all-weather interception capabilities. Navigation was supported by the AN Aaron 21 Takan system, allowing precise location and course plotting. The redesigned Voodoo, now equipped with its new inlets, T-tail, and reinforced structure, underwent rigorous evaluations. By March 1953, it had successfully impressed Air Force officials, leading to an order for 29 F-101As on May 28, 1953. This decision to bypass the traditional prototype phase and move directly into low-rate production highlighted the confidence in the Voodoo's design and its potential impact on air power. The result was a monumental achievement. The F-101 Voodoo was a powerful high-tech machine, but above all, it was fast. A particular variant, the JF-101A, set a world speed record of 1,207.6 miles per hour during Operation Firewall, surpassing the previous record held by the Ferry Delta II. Though its reign was brief, with the Lockheed F-104 Starfighter taking the crown in May 1958, the Voodoo's performance highlighted its exceptional design and engineering. The Tactical Air Command saw the potential in the Voodoo and implemented numerous modifications to enhance its capabilities. These upgrades included advanced air-to-ground communication systems, the capacity to carry additional external pods, and structural reinforcements to manage the increased stress from its expanded arsenal. These enhancements transformed the Voodoo into a potent fighter bomber capable of delivering a decisive nuclear strike against strategic targets like enemy airfields. On May 2, 1957, the first F-101A rolled out, destined for the 27th Strategic Fighter Wing. This unit transitioned to TACS command in July of the same year, replacing their F-84 F-Thunderstreaks with the advanced Voodoo. The aircraft's cutting-edge technology and superior performance made it an invaluable addition to the fleet. Equipped with the MA-7 fire control radar and a low-altitude bombing system, the F-101A was a versatile platform for both air-to-air combat and nuclear strike missions. Its primary weapon was the MK-28 atomic bomb, a thermonuclear warhead with a yield of up to 1,450 kilotons of TNT. The Voodoo could also accommodate other nuclear warheads, including the MK-7, MK-43, and MK-57, though it typically did not carry conventional weapons in combat scenarios. Additionally, the F-101A was armed with four 20mm M39 cannons, though one cannon was often replaced with a Takan beacon receiver for navigation purposes. Of the 77 F-101 as produced, only 50 were operationally deployed, with the remaining aircraft utilized for advancing aviation research and development. Despite its early teething problems, including a maneuverability ceiling of 6.33 Gs, the F-101A Voodoo was embraced by the Tactical Air Command with open arms. By 1957, the Voodoo underwent a transformation, emerging as the F-101C. This variant could pull 7.33 Gs in a dogfight and boasted several upgrades, including a beefier structure and a revamped fuel system. On July 12, 1957, the RF-101C made its maiden flight while utilizing the F-101C's sturdy structure. Designed to fly unarmed, this super spy jet replaced radar and guns with up to six cameras concealed in its sleek nose. It entered service in 1958. It had passive defenses such as the AN-APS-54 radar warning receiver, but it gave up real all-weather capabilities when the AN-APN-82 electronic navigation system was discarded. The original plan called for 166 RF-101Cs, with 96 of those planes converted to fighter bombers. The Voodoo's reputation was also based on how fast it was. During Operation Sunrun on November 27, 1957, Captain Robert Sweet flew an RF-101C from Los Angeles to New York City and returned in 6 hours and 46 minutes, and from New York to Los Angeles in 3 hours and 36 minutes. This flight set coast-to-coast records. Another RF-101C, flown by Lieutenant Gustav Klatt, demonstrated the remarkable speed and performance of the aircraft by completing the flight from Los Angeles to New York in just 3 hours and 7 minutes. Once flying with the 27th Tactical Fighter Wing in Texas, these aviators quickly found a new home with the 81st Tactical Fighter Wing in Europe by 1958. They stood guard as a strategic nuclear spear ready to strike at the Soviet Union's core if the Cold War was to erupt into combat. Skillfully navigating their Voodoos through enemy defenses, these elite pilots of TAC could deliver their nuclear payloads in the worst-case scenario. In the 1960s, however, the unstoppable F-4C Phantom II supplanted the Voodoo as the nation's nuclear deterrent. The RF-101H, an unarmed reconnaissance version that saw service until 1972, was developed out of a few Voodoos. In spite of this change, the Voodoo continued to have a significant influence, especially during the Cuban Missile Crisis when the RF-101C demonstrated its strengths in actual reconnaissance flights. The most catastrophic conflict of the Cold War began when a U-2 spy plane discovered Soviet R-12 ballistic missile installations in Cuba on October 14, 1962. Urgent action was required against the missile installations, which were protected by SA-2 surface-to-air missiles. The reconnaissance and fighter-bomber versions of the Voodoo aircraft were sent out in a flash. The positions of Cuban missiles, which were encircled by SAM installations, necessitated rapid low-altitude surveillance. The RF-101A and C Voodoos of the Tactical Air Command were assigned the mission of monitoring Soviet actions and charting their strategic maneuvers. The United States air defenses were brought dangerously close to nuclear war when President Kennedy announced the Soviet missiles. Air defense forces dispatched interceptors to emergency fields. Fighters were positioned near Florida, and our bombers were on continual alert, preparing for a Soviet assault, as remembered by F-101B pilot Jonathan Meyer. Armed with AIM-4C Falcon missiles and AIR-2 Agini nuclear rockets, the F-101Bs were prepared for action. Meyer recalled, quote, "We flew fully loaded in pairs with nukes and IR missiles ready. Landing on Billings' unprepared runway incurred a few cut tires, while our makeshift alert area was cordoned off and a 24-hour phone alert set up in a hangar." Fortunately, no Soviet escalation ensued, and a couple of weeks later we returned to Glasgow to resume regular alert and training. According to Bon Hansen, who was flying an F-101C, he was on alert as the Cuban Missile Crisis intensified. Quote, "From 9 o'clock in the morning until sunset, we were on red cockpit alert. For more than 7 days, we were prepared to launch." By exchanging the U.S. removal of Jupiter missiles from Turkey and Italy for the Soviet withdrawal of their missiles from Cuba, the crisis was averted and the situation came to a close. Amidst the chaos, the RF-101C Voodoos performed crucial reconnaissance flights, ensuring that Soviet missile sites had been destroyed and preventing a possible end of the world.